Yes, we'll start at verse 12. This is the part where Ruth has met Boaz and she's working in his fields. And she says, "May the Lord repay you," he says, "for what you have done. May you be richly rewarded by the Lord, the God of Israel, under whose wings you have come to take refuge. May I continue to find favor in your eyes, my Lord," she said. "You have given me comfort and have spoken kindly to your servant, and though I don't have the standing of one of your servant girls." At mealtime, Boaz said to her, "Come over here, have some bread and dip it in wine vinegar." Then she sat down with the harvesters. He offered her some roasted grain. She ate all that she wanted and had some left over. As she got up to glean, Boaz gave orders to his men. "Even if she gathers some sheep among the sheaves, don't embarrass her. Rather, pull out some stalks for her from the bundles and leave them for her to pick up, and don't rebuke her." So Ruth gleaned in the field until evening. Then she threshed the barley she had gathered, and it amounted to about an ephah, and that's about 22 litres. She carried it back to town and to her mother-in-law, and when she saw how much she had gathered, Ruth also brought out and gave her what she had left over after she'd eaten enough. Her mother-in-law asked her, "Where did you glean today? Where did you work? Blessed be the man who took notice of you." Then Ruth told her mother-in-law about the one at whose place she had been working. "The name of the man I worked with today is Boaz," she said. "The Lord bless him," Naomi said to her daughter-in-law. "He's not stopped showing his kindness to the living and the dead." She added, "The man is our close relative. He's one of our kinsmen redeemers." Then Ruth the Moabitess said, "He even said to me, 'Stay with my workers until they finish the harvesting all my grain.'" Naomi said to Ruth, "It will be good for you, my daughter, to go with his girls, because in someone else's field you might be harmed." So Ruth stayed close to the servant girls of Boaz to glean until the barley harvest and wheat harvest were finished, and she lived with her mother-in-law. One day, Naomi, her mother-in-law, said to her, "My daughter, should I not try to find a home for you where you will be well provided for? Is not Boaz, with whose servant girls you have been a kinsman of ours? Tonight he will be winnowing barley on the threshing floor. Wash and perfume yourself and put on your best clothes. Then go down to the threshing floor, but don't let him know that you're there until he's finished eating and drinking. When he lies down, note the place where he is lying. Then go and uncover his feet and lie down. He will tell you what to do." "I'll do whatever you say," Ruth answered. So she went down to the threshing floor and did everything her mother-in-law told her to do. When Boaz had finished eating and drinking and was in good spirits, he went over to lie down at the far end of the grain pile. Ruth approached quietly, uncovered his feet and lay down. In the middle of the night, something startled the man, and he turned and discovered a woman lying at his feet. "Who are you?" he asked. "I'm your servant Ruth," she said. "Spread the corner of your garment over me, since you are my kinsman redeemer." "The Lord bless you, my daughter," he replied. "This kindness is greater than which you showed earlier. You've not run after the younger men, whether rich or poor. And now, my daughter, don't be afraid. I will do for you all you ask. All my fellow townsmen know you are a woman of noble character. Although it's true that I am a near kin, there is a kinsman redeemer nearer than I. Stay here for the night, and in the morning, if he wants to redeem, good, let him redeem. But if he's not willing, as surely as the Lord lives, I will do it. Lie here till morning." So she lay at his feet until morning, but got up before anyone could be recognized. And he said, "Don't let it be known that a woman came to the threshing floor." He also said, "Bring me the shawl that you're wearing and hold it out." And when she did, he poured into it 6 measures of barley and put it on her. Then he went back to town. When Ruth came to her mother-in-law, Naomi, she asked, How did it go, my daughter?" Then she told her everything Boaz had done for her and added, "He gave me these 6 measures of barley, saying, 'Don't go back to your mother-in-law empty-handed.'" Then Naomi said, "Wait, my daughter, until you find out what happens, for the man will not rest until the matter is settled today." Dun, dun, dun. I love this story, you know. And we continue. No. I suppose we should say last time in the book of Ruth. Well, in chapter 1, what we actually saw, I'm going to do a little bit of a recap. We saw bitterness and the providence of God in the life of Naomi as she left the country, lost her husband, lost her sons, and then she lost one of her daughters-in-law. She encourages her to go home. But all was not lost because God has provided in the midst of the disaster. First of all, he's broke the famine, and the famine that actually precipitated the decision to go to Moab in the first place had been broken so she can go home. And secondly, Ruth has actually stayed with her to be her companion and committed herself, almost a marriage commitment, to stay with her and care for her. And we saw last time that whilst all of this was happening in Moab, back in Judah, this distant relative called Boaz was actually being prepared to be Ruth's husband and actually to bear the Messiah. This is an amazing story, isn't it? But we decided that although hindsight is a wonderful science, all that Naomi could see was desperation and hopelessness. Remember, she said, "Don't call me Naomi," which means pleasant. "Call me Mara, because the Almighty has made my life very bitter." And the fact was that she was blinded, wasn't she, to what was going on, because her life was just full up and she'd had enough. And in chapter 2, God reveals himself so clearly that even Naomi can see. And I don't know about you, but when I read her responses in chapter 2 and I see the change in her, I sense there's suddenly an excitement about this woman that is so different from the picture that we've had so far. But then it makes me realise that that's just so typical of humanity, isn't it? So often we're caught between a rock and a hard place and we're unable to see the next step. And then from somewhere totally unexpected, there's a light, isn't there? Have you ever wondered why that happens? Why that is a surprise to us? Well, I'll tell you why it is. It's because our own agenda has been colouring our life and our view so that we've actually become blind to the things of God. And the big I takes over, so it's what I know, what I will, what I want. And when I takes over, there's no room for anyone else, is there? Then we were introduced to Boaz for the first time. This is a wealthy guy. He's a relative of Ruth's dead husband. But more importantly, which is being stressed in the text, he's actually a man of faith. And we saw the way that he deals with people. When he came in, "The Lord bless you," he says to his servants. You know, they like working for him. He takes people on because he trusts them. And actually, he acknowledges that Ruth is a woman of, well, certainly in public opinion, an honourable woman, because she's looked after her mother-in-law. And she's one who's at the early stages of faith. And he says to her, "I'm glad you've come to us. And I know you've come to be under God's wings." And you remember we looked at Psalm 91 when we talked about the cherubim above the ark and the safe place of God, the mercy seat. And this is what this is implying. You've come to be part of God's people. And then we looked at the other scriptures in Leviticus where it talks about welcoming the foreigner in. And actually welcoming these people from different lands as one of your own. Because God knows all. And so then chapter 2 helped us to see something more of Ruth and Boaz. But it also showed us something very important. It showed us the beginnings of this spiritual recovery for Naomi as well. And that's a great encouragement, isn't it? Because I'm sure of us, all of us have been down at some time to the point where we think there's no way back. But actually, God in his mercy reaches out, even in those desperate moments, and lifts us back up again. There's always a hand there. "He drew me from a fearful pit, up from the miry clay, and set my feet upon a rock, establishing my way. He put a new song in my mouth, a song of praise to God. Many will see and fear and put their trust in the Lord." Oh, doesn't that want to make you go, doesn't it? You know, this is God actually reaching out in those desperate moments and saying, "There is a way back." There's another hymn there, isn't there? "There's a way back to God from the dark paths of sin." Hey, well, we're not going to sing that just now. Not the way you've been singing this morning anyway. Okay. But then we come to chapter 3 and we have these three major characters again. There's Boaz, the man of faith. There's Ruth, a young woman on the threshold of faith, and we're assuming that. And Naomi, an old lady who through tough times has lost sight of so much, but who is now beginning to renew her faith in the sovereignty of God. This is lovely, isn't it? You can see the ground being prepared. I tell you, if you're going to ever write a book, you ought to go here first to see how the writer brings this all together. And we can see that all three characters are being careful to behave in a right manner. They're demonstrating an ability to think big picture, to see that their existence is part of something that's far, far greater than themselves. Actually, they're thinking the way that we should think. They're thinking prophetically. Do you remember the rock in the pool we talk about often? Remember? We don't think, we often think in a linear way, A goes to B, goes to C equals D. But actually, God wants us to think big picture, that our past makes our present and our present makes our future. It's not just linear, it all matters. It's like a rock in a pool. And the ripples that we send out and the decisions that we make are very, very important. So we have to think about everything we do. Now, there's an interesting New Testament parallel, actually, in Ephesians 5 and 15. Let me read it to you. In the New International Version, is quite weak, I think. It says, "Be very careful then how you live, not as unwise, but as wise, making the most of every opportunity, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the Lord's will is." Now, it's interesting. The translation in the King James Version, which I don't read often, actually says this: "So then, see that ye walk circumspectly." What a beautiful word. "Not as fools, but as wise, redeeming the time, because the days are evil. Wherefore, be ye not unwise, but understanding of what the Lord's will is." Both verses are saying the same thing. Both translations are saying the same thing. But the word circumspectly seems just to hold the whole thing together, doesn't it? And it means that we've got to start thinking big picture. We have to understand that God has got a purpose in everything we do, that he allows us to make decisions, good or bad. But whatever happens, there is a consequence. But you know, it doesn't matter how bad the decision sometimes, God can rescue us from that as well. But it is better to make the right decision. Now, without realizing it, Naomi, Ruth, and Boaz are actually being quite circumspect in their thinking. Might be something to do with their age. It might be something to do with their culture. I'm not quite sure of that yet. Now, they're thinking about the consequences of their actions and careful to consider the reaction of other people involved in their lives. Now, as the story begins to unfold, we see an intentional, it's an almost planned right living that goes beyond this passive righteousness that simply avoids doing evil. In their intent, there's actually an initiative to do what is right. In fact, what they're doing is living in the moment and thinking in the eternal. Now, that's maybe where we need to get to as Christian people. We need to understand we live in the present, but we have to think of the eternal consequences of how we live. And there is a clue there to participating in the divine nature of God. Now, turn with me, if you would, to 2 Peter. Just quickly, we're going to read this. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. "His divine power has given us everything we need for godliness, for a life and godliness through our knowledge of him who called us by his own glory and goodness. Through these he has given us his very great and precious promises, so that through them you might participate in the divine nature and escape the corruption in the world caused by evil desires. For this reason, make every effort to add to your faith goodness, and to goodness knowledge, and to knowledge self-control, and to self-control perseverance, and to perseverance godliness, and to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness love. For if you possess these qualities in increasing measure, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But if anyone does not have them, he is short-sighted and blind, and has forgotten that he's been cleansed from his past sins." It's almost a mandate here, isn't it? "Therefore, my brothers, be all the more eager to make your calling and election sure. For if you do all these things, you will never fall. And you will receive a rich welcome into the eternal kingdom of our Lord Jesus, our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ." Now, if we go back to the text, an interesting lesson is to be had from this chapter. And that is that the hope of God places in our hearts enables us to dream good dreams. Hope enables us to do well and teaches us to chase after those dreams with virtue and integrity. And it's when there's no hope that humanity drops its standards and all kinds of substandards seem to creep in. I don't know if you watched any movie buffs here. You know, any watched those all the films about nuclear war in the 80s? Do you remember those? There's a whole screed of films on about. Do you remember those? And they were really depressing, you know, because everyone dies in the end. Okay, but it's the drama of people and how people cope with, you know, the surety of death. In fact, I watched one the other day. It was really depressing, but it was actually quite interesting at the same time. There was no hope, but it was interesting just how quick society seems to break down in these films when there's no hope. When there is no hope, the society breaks down. And the interesting thing is, it's only the Christians in the story that seem to want to continue on strong to the end. But they don't always come out very well in the films. Now, I think that's very important. But hope that is confident, you see, confident of the activity and movement of God in our lives, creates in us this desire to do and develop all those things that are true and noble and right and pure and lovely and admirable and excellent and praiseworthy. I sound like the Apostle Paul now, straight from Philippians 4. And this is so clear in the lives of these three people. You see it all evidenced. It's almost bubbles to the top as you read the story. So if you want a first heading, and there are just three short headings today. First one is Naomi's strategy. Turn with me to chapter 3, verse 1. One day, I love that, once upon a time. One day, Naomi, her mother-in-law, said to her, "My daughter, should I not try to find a home for you where you'll be well provided for?" Interesting, if we go back to chapter 1, do you remember? She said, "You know, I've got nothing for you." Now she's got everything. See the hope coming through there. "Is not Boaz, with whose servant girls you've been, a kinsman of ours? Tonight he'll be winnowing barley on the threshing floor. Wash and perfume yourself, put on your best clothes, then go down to the threshing floor, but don't let him know you're there until he's finished eating and drinking. When he lies down, note the place where he's lying, and then go and uncover his feet and lie down. He will tell you what to do." "I'll do whatever you say," Ruth answered. See, the fact that Naomi has a strategy teaches us something right away. If we feel that we are a victim all the time, we're never going to make plans. Just take a look at the chapter 1, as I just mentioned, then you'll see Naomi fitted that category. And now look at this woman, seeing beyond her misery, not using her perceived suffering as a tool to bang someone over the head with or to get sympathy vote, but now she's moving on with God. From the point that she saw the goodness of God again, her life and her outlook is beginning to change. And now she's seeing beyond herself. And look at this. She's actually considering Ruth for the first time. Up until that point, she's not taken much notice, has she? You see, when things don't go our way, we usually go into a self-preservation mode. We play the blame game, don't we? We throw our teddies out of the cot and we mope around and we feel sorry for ourselves. But there's grace here, you see. The nature of hope is that it has to be passed on. And that's a real lesson for the church, to hope in God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. It's true, you know, that churches that experience hope plan and strategize for the future. A church that talks about hope but doesn't experience it develops a routine of going through a set program year after year after year, and I've been in many of them. But when a church feels the sovereign kindness of God, when a church engages with Jesus and experiences the movement of the Holy Spirit, hope begins to thrive, and living in righteousness ceases to be a simple avoidance of evil. And it becomes an activity that is strategic and full of purpose in its expression. That's where we've got to be if we're going to have meaning and purpose in this world. If we're going to be useful to God in his economy. Now, I read a lovely story of hope, actually. It was this lady who is in America. Of course, it always happens in America. But this lady was dying. She'd been diagnosed with a terminal illness. Didn't have long to go, and she asked the pastor to come round to help her sort out the funeral. He said, "Yeah, no bother." So they went round and they prayed together and they looked at the reading she'd like at a funeral. They talked about the hymns. And then he closed in prayer and he was just leaving. She said, "Oh, pastor, there's one other thing. She said, yeah, and you know, in American funerals, they have the casket open at the front so that you can see the person laying there, and then everyone files past, you see. She said, just one of the things, would you make sure there's a fork in my right hand? And she said, oh, you're a bit puzzled now, aren't you? He said, yeah. He said, well, actually, I'll tell you what this is about. She said, when I've been to church socials over the years, when they come to clear the meal away, someone always says, keep your fork. And she says, I know then that there's going to be a lovely pudding coming. You know, there's going to be a chocolate cake, or it's going to be a nice apple pie or something. So what I want you to do is put that fork in my hand. So when people go past my casket, they'll say, what's with the fork? And then I want you to tell them, you keep your fork because the best is yet to come. Isn't that a wonderful story? And really quite inspiring of hope, you see. Let's come back to the text for a minute. In taking the initiative to find a husband for Ruth, this is hope again. Naomi comes up with this strange plan. She identifies Boaz as a kinsman, as a relative, and this makes him a likely candidate. That way, the family name and the family inheritance will stay in the family according to Hebrew tradition. Now you can see what she's doing. She's got hope. She's beginning to strategize and she's beginning to plan. See, all the markers that are there. Can't be a bad thing. So Naomi's aim is really clear. She wants to win Ruth a godly husband and a secure future, but also the preservation of the family line. And so she tells Ruth to make herself as attractive as possible, to go to the threshing floor of Boaz, and after he's settled for the night, sneak in, lift up his cloak and lie down at his feet. Now this could be actually considered to be a really strange thing to do, and possibly it could give the wrong impression. It's really quite risky. But Naomi has actually read into the situation. She says a very interesting thing. Look at verse 4, the second half. It says, then go and uncover his feet and lie down. Listen to his phrase. He will tell you what to do. That's important. At first glance, there is one thing that is clear and one thing that is not. It is clear that this is Naomi's way of trying to get Boaz to marry Ruth. Okay? Confusion. Okay? What is not clear is why she should go about it like this. Why did she not invite him around for tea and just speak to him? You know, what she's actually got here is a really highly suggestive and a risky midnight maneuver. But the likelihood is that Naomi has seen and heard that Boaz is a man of integrity and she trusts him completely. It's also likely that she knew that Boaz, being a man of God and an older man and a man who was so impressed with Ruth's integrity, would be moved at being approached in such a way, and it could only mean marriage to him. And his behaviour from chapter 2 displays that he values other people and that he's not the sort that would actually take advantage of her. And this was... it was a sexually tempting strategy. There's no two ways around it. And one that could have led to an illicit affair, but the opposite was true, of course. And what we see is a scene of purity and self-control and honour and righteousness. Although, with hindsight, we can see that. I'm not sure that's how it was seen in the beginning. So we've had Naomi's strategy. Secondly, we have Ruth's obedience. Now, verse 5, she has said that she would follow Naomi's instructions. But actually, Ruth does more. Okay, now Naomi has said that Boaz would tell Ruth what to do, but before that happens, Ruth tells Boaz why she's there. Look at it, verse 5. I will do whatever you say, Ruth answered. So she went down to the threshing floor and did everything her mother-in-law told her to do, so she'd done it. When Boaz had finished eating and drinking, was in good spirits, he went over to lie down at the far end of the grain pile. Ruth approached quietly, uncovered his feet and laid down. In the middle of the night, something startled the man, and he turned and discovered a woman lying at his feet. Who are you? He asked. Now, she's waiting for him to tell him what to do, but she says, I'm Ruth, your servant, she says. That's all she'd been told to do. And she said, spread the corner of your garment over me, since you're my kinsman redeemer. Ah, women. Always got to have their last word, don't they? Eh? I've got permission to say that, by the way. Okay. What she actually literally said was, you are the one who can redeem our inheritance and our family name from being lost. I want you to fill that role. I want to be your wife. Now, Ruth is not offering a sexual relationship. That would have been against the law and it would have been morally wrong. And here's the integrity. She's saying, in effect, I would like to be the one to whom you pledge your faithfulness with, and with whom you make a marriage covenant. Now, I don't recommend that this is a strategy you should employ today, okay? But actually, within its culture, it was appropriate. But there's more to it than that. And this is the second indication of subtlety and depth. When Ruth said, spread your garment, or your literally your skirt over me, the word for garment or skirt in the Hebrew is the word for wing. That's interesting, isn't it? Mm-hmm. You also see it in Ezekiel chapter 16 and verse 8. This is God speaking to Jerusalem. It says, later I passed by, and when I looked at you and saw that you were old enough for love, I spread the corner of my garment over you and covered your nakedness. I gave you my solemn oath and entered into a covenant with you, declares the sovereign Lord, and you became mine. Now that is significant, and I'll tell you why. Because the only other place that that word is used in Scripture is here in Ruth. Namely, in the key verse from last time, in verse 12, and we'll come to that in a minute. But what we saw last time was that Boaz was used by God to reward Ruth. He gave her free access to his field. He gave her protection from the young men. He gave her refreshment from the water jars. And Ruth asked Boaz, why have I found favour in your eyes? Now see the story building. Boaz replied, I've been told all about what you have done for your mother-in-law since the death of your husband. How you left your father and mother in your homeland and came to live with a people you did not know before. Here it is. May the Lord repay you for what you have done. May you be richly rewarded by the Lord, the God of Israel, under whose wings you have come to take refuge. Now, here's the theory. Okay? It's a theory. Okay? And it's a possible key to understanding actually what's going on here. Ruth has told Naomi about these words of Boaz. And the more they think about them, the more they become convinced that there is a personal meaning here. So perhaps what Boaz really meant is, because you've taken refuge under the wings of God, you're my kind of woman, and I want to cover you with my wings. Being a man, and an older man with authority, he wouldn't have been able to express affection publicly, not certainly not easily. For Boaz, Ruth would have been an attractive proposition, not because she was young, but because primarily she was seen as a woman of faith and integrity. And it all sounds a bit tenuous, I know, but just consider this. He said he admired her for coming under God's wings. And he acted as though he was actually under his wings because he provided for her. And eventually, in the course of time, Naomi and Ruth hit upon a response that is just as subtle and just as profound. And the result is that Ruth will come to him in his sleep, in the grain field where he's taken her under his care, and she will say yes. It's all very symbolic, but she will say it not with words, but with an action just as subtle and as profound as the action and the words of Boaz. And what she literally does is she puts herself under his wing. Do you see it? And when he wakes up, everything hangs on one sentence as to whether or not she's got it right. That's pretty risky, isn't it? She must have been so nervous. Imagine, I bet she didn't sleep. And when he wakes up and they're looking at each other, can you see it? And imagine the silence as Boaz realises what's going on. And now we know that actually she's read his signals. Who are you? I'm your servant Ruth, she said. Spread the corner of your garment over me since you are my kinsman redeemer. Here we've got a middle-aged man in love with a young widow who he discreetly calls my daughter. Uncertain whether her heart might be going after the younger men. And communicating in the best way that he knows how, that he wants to be God's wings for her. And we have a young widow gradually reading between the lines with the help of her wise mother-in-law and finally ready to risk misinterpretation by coming in the middle of night to take refuge under the wing of his garment. That's really powerful, romantic stuff, isn't it? So we've got Naomi's strategy, we've got Ruth's obedience, then we have Boaz's response. Now, bear in mind the scene. It's midnight. The woman of his dreams has read his signals of affection, and now he's looking into her eyes. The Lord bless you, my daughter. Verse 10. This kindness is greater than that which you showed earlier. You've not run after a younger man, whether rich or poor. And now, my daughter, don't be afraid. I will do for you all you ask. All my fellow townsmen know that you're a woman of noble character. He doesn't make life awkward for her at all. You know, he's just gracious to her, isn't he? And then incredibly, the noble words of integrity, he goes on, verse 12. Although it's true that I'm your near kin, there is a kinsman redeemer nearer than me. Stay here for the night, and in the morning, if he wants to redeem you, good, let him redeem. But if he's not willing, as surely as the Lord lives, I will do it. You lie here till the morning. He knows what he wants. But he's not willing just to take what he wants. He's in a position to do that. He can do it. He's a man of power. But because he's an upright, noble guy, he won't do it. It's a beautiful night. They're clearly attracted to each other. She's under his cloak, and he shows her the honour by not taking any advantage, but promising to do what is right in the eyes of God. Now, here's the lesson. In our society, we face a society that has become so weak, that's largely forgotten morality and propriety and consigned it to the bin as old-fashioned. The try before you buy attitude seems to pervade all relationships, doesn't it? It seems to spill over. But the strategy for living correctly and with integrity is seen within these three people, because God was actually considered first in a decision. And it doesn't matter where you are in your life. It doesn't matter what mistakes you've made in your life. The fact is, there is always a starting place for you. God is putting his hand out to you. And he's saying, look, here is a starting place. Put me first and it will be all right. That's always the wise way if you're going to be a pilgrim. Trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge him, and he'll make your path straight. And we continue. And next time, let's pray together, shall we? Our Father God, we thank you so much that you're willing to reach in and lift us out of that filthy mire that we put ourselves in. That you're willing to lift us up and stand us on a rock and hold us up and put that new song of hope into our hearts. And grant us the ability by your Spirit to rejoice in sins forgiven and the hope of heaven. We thank you too that on this journey that we travel with you in faith, that you enable us to be the best pilgrims that we can be. And you understand how we slip and slide sometimes all over the place. But we thank you that our spirituality can be normal, that it can be possible, that it can be notable, and that you can have all the glory. So help us this day, we pray, to trust you that little bit more, and to always seek that starting place with you. For we ask it in Jesus' lovely name and for his glory alone. Amen. Amen.